we choose a research topic. And so obviously throughout marketing, finance, corporate finance, I'd been writing about banking because that's where I had been. And then at the point of writing my dissertation, I suddenly said, I want to write about the creative industry. And my supervisor was upset because here's my supervisor in the UK already overwhelmed with all her students. And then you are going on a completely different trajectory. And she's like, "What? Where are you going to get research material from to write about creative industry in Ghana?" And I said, "I'll do primary research." And she was like, "You know you're going to have a hard time." And I said, "Yes, I know. Are you ready to go through what it takes?" I said, "Yes, I will." So now here I was with a supervisor who was not interested in my topic, and I was at a crossroads. I spent a whole lot of money to do that MBA with Lancaster University. And I said, "Do you take the safe way, write about banking, go into marketing, this is your area, write about it, do an excellent paper and get your grade? Or do you want to use the next 6 months to delve into the area which is your next level, so that whether you get the grade that you want or not, you get the knowledge that you need?" And so I took that bold step and I wrote about the creative industry. First, I wanted to write about theater and film combined, and I realized it was very hard to get information about theater. So I had a chat with Ajiti and I said, "I want to write about building a strategy in the creative industry in Ghana, and I don't know who to start talking to." And he said, "Well, there's more data in film in Ghana than theater. So let's start from Silverbird." So I went to Silverbird, I spoke with the marketing manager, and I said, "Can I have data, box office data, revenue data from the last 10 years since Silverbird came to Ghana?" And he said, "Yes, you can." So that's where I started my research. And I finished, so obviously because my supervisor was not happy, every time I submitted work, she would take a while to, you know, review it, and the feedback was not encouraging. But I didn't give up. So I finished my MBA with information, priceless information. I interviewed the top 5 film producers in Ghana over the last 5 years. I spoke to them about all the films they'd done, the financing structures, their management structures, their business strategies, marketing, distribution, everything. And I had great people, Shirley Frimpong-Mansell, Kofas Media, Peter Sedufia, Yvonne Okoro, Yvonne Nelson, and a few others. I spoke to all of them and then I chose the top 5 based on the data I had from Silverbird. And I finished my MBA with a B instead of an A in my dissertation. Because I really wanted to get an A despite all that. But I held that result and I said, I have something they can't take away from me. And for me, that was the beginning of the next phase of my life. So I finished in 2018, and by 2020, I'd started talking to the people that I wanted to work with. And maybe we'll go into the presentation later, but I just will talk about his own journey. So yes, right now we are neck deep in creative arts, and banking and finance is my past. Thank you.
All right, so yeah.
So let's go back to Ajete's story. Yeah.
So here I was, 2007, getting ready for marriage, and I had done acting for quite a bit. And you know, I think at that point I'd found my purpose. I knew that this was the calling, this is the area which God wanted me to exhibit my skill and talent and be a blessing. But the value wasn't valuing, because now, you know, I'm gonna put money on the table. I mean, where it was just me, I could buy my kinky and fish, and you know, I could have it twice a day, and I'm sorted.
And Tampico and Kelewele. You know, he used to eat Tampico and Kelewele every day in the university.
But here comes this lady, and you know, it means that my diet has to change. You know, I have to make sure that I have other assorted things. And looking at the income that was coming and inconsistency in a field that I am called to be, I was like, "Charlie, God, this will make you chill small." So I diverted. I went into the corporate space where I worked with a packaging manufacturing company. And it, for consistency
years.
Of, you know, at the end of the month, I know that something is coming, as against being in the industry where you are not sure when your next project is coming. And because I didn't also have capital to do works on my own, so you are dependent on others. And so there I went into this corporate space and doing, you know, corporate, white-collar job, up and down. But there was no joy. I come home and I don't even talk to her because I'm so drained with this up and down work, marketing. I was the head of marketing department of this cotton manufacturing company, and I didn't find fulfillment in what I was doing. And I remember that even in those times when I do have projects that come in once in a while, it's like a breakthrough for me. And at a point, she realized it, that look, I was not happy with the job I was doing, even though there was consistency at the end of the month. And so she thought that, look, why don't you get back into the industry, which is your first calling, and let's see how it works out. And so with her encouragement, I delved back into my field and began the journey all over again. And that's, of course, led me to do a diploma in theater arts and then first degree as well, the master's degree. And here I am today. The difference with this is that I came into a field where people were relying solely on talents and their giftings. And as we've just heard from the parable of the talents, there's always that which is embedded in us that we need to add value to, and that makes it whole. And therefore, in exhibiting our talents and giftings, then we're impacting lives the way we should, other than just relying on talents and giftings and not adding value to it. And there's so many of those persons in our industry just rely on their physique, their looks. You know, they have one or two things that would use as a leverage, and then they have opportunities and offers, but then they are not able to fully impact because they haven't found that value to make a difference. And so, like she said, that was what led us to ensure that education was key and for us to move on with this giftings. Can we move to the next slide, please?
Okay, so I think I spoke through this along the line. My love for creative and performing arts started from childhood. My father used to take my brothers and I to the National Theatre a lot. In fact, on one of those productions, I saw this lanky guy on the stage on a production called the one the Anansi, the no, not Marriage of Anansiwa, the well, the one with the well, Secrets of an Ancient Well. And he was on stage. You know, I saw a picture recently in one of his old albums. And when I saw it, I said, I remember this scene. I was probably about 9 or 10 years old at the time he was on stage on that performance. And then I sang a song that was sung in the production, and he couldn't believe it. I said, I was there. I saw you on stage, you know. So I've loved creative arts from when I was a child. I used to do art competitions. Oh, I was going to bring some of my artworks. During COVID, I started to do art again. I did some painting on canvas, etc. But both of my parents, both of my parents were visual artists. My mom was a textile designer. We lost her 4 years ago. And she was a textile designer. So she worked with some of the textile factories. Growing up, she worked with Anitex and then did some work for, I think, ATL or so. So she was designing fabrics. And then also clothes, she did some clothes designing as well. And my dad was an art teacher. He taught art for maybe about 20-something years, from Nigeria, in Badagry Grammar School, taught art at Accra High School. And then he retired as head of art department at Ghana International School. And so both parents were in the creative arts. And then I mentioned that my father used to take us to watch performances, and I've always loved piano music, orchestra music, dance, etc. I still wonder why I can't dance. But I have these two guys here, I've been asking to teach me to dance, and they don't help me. So I don't know. But that's my story. Can we go to the next slide if there's anything else? So in senior high school, I studied economics, geography, literature, French. I mentioned about my audition for Things to Do for Love, and I never imagined myself on stage. I never ever did. And later on, you also saw the role I played in Sun City, Khadija. And I learned so much more about myself. I learned so much about the things that really make me, you know, want to do more, the things I'm passionate about, the things I love to do. And I mentioned also that I studied my first degree in English and Theater Arts. So the next stage was a corporate world. And as I mentioned, next slide, please. As I mentioned, every So these were some of my acting attempts. Okay, next slide. Every single experience that I've had in the corporate world has shaped my understanding, especially of creative business. As Ajete mentioned, a lot of people in the creative space, not just in Ghana, but in a lot of places, don't have the opportunity or do not look at it as the business, on the business side. There's a lot of business in the creative industry. I did a lot of research about Hollywood and Bollywood and Nollywood and all the revenue that comes out of the creative industry, and it's mind-boggling. And at a point, you realize that it's difficult for creatives, a lot of creatives, to put certain structures in place in their business. So creators need business people who understand the creative industry to be able to help them to put structure and form to what they do. And that's one of the spaces that I believe that I'm called into. So my experience in the banking industry, I mentioned, so I had some exposure to human capital development. My first job after school was with Legacy and Legacy. Please clap for Lady Comfort Okran. That was my first job, and that was when I learned to understand about developing human capital. I loved some of the programs that we did, helping people develop business, develop themselves, to develop business strategies. And then I went into the banking environment where I did the entire spectrum of business development. I started with retail banking, I went into SME banking, commercial banking, and then corporate banking. So every customer type I managed or I dealt with along the line in my banking career, and that was the scope. The skills I learned included relationship management, business development, credit analysis, financial statement analysis, etc. I hated finance before I went into banking. It was one of the things I was really afraid of, that I won't be able to understand the figures, I won't be able to understand accounting. So I challenged myself that if I find myself here, then I might as well put myself into the process. So I'm proud to say that, and it's one of the things I always say is my achievement, one of my greatest achievements in banking, is that we had a very renowned credit agency in Africa come to do a bootcamp training for about 50 team leads when I was in Access Bank, and I was the first in financial statement analysis and accounting. I mean, when the results came out, I burst out laughing because I couldn't believe it was me they were talking about. What I did was I sat right in front of the class. It was a 2-week bootcamp out of Accra. I sat right in front. It was just me and the lecturers. I couldn't see anybody because I said, the last thing I want to do is to fail this, you know, and then to reinforce the fact that I'm not good at this. So these were some of the experiences I had. And then I went on along the line to do my master's, I mentioned. I chose a project in creative industry for the purposes of the place where I knew I was going. And then I meshed all the years of business, finance, my love for creativity and all that. When together with Ajete, we founded a company now called Meraki Arts Africa. Meraki is a beautiful dream come true. I think we will share that along the line. But it's a partnership of creative and business professionals. We have got some really serious people on that team. I mean, we have 2 PhD holders. I think one of them is a prof's mentee, Niyayi Solomon. He's a partner in our business. And we also have, we have 2 people currently pursuing PhDs as partners. We have chartered accountants, top managers in some of the big firms in this country, all as partners in Meraki. And the dream is to do creativity at the highest level, or to do creative business at the highest level, and then also to have very strict business skills, very strong business structures as well. So I finally took a bold step out of my comfort zone, which surprisingly had become banking and finance. It was a difficult decision to leave an industry I'd be very comfortable in. And by God's grace, I say I thrived. I did well. My last year, 2023, was exceptional. And I'm also grateful to God to say that every financial institution I've worked in, if I go back today and I say I want to work here again, they will take me back with arms open wide, because I believe that I did what I was supposed to do. And so I'm coming into the creative space not having failed in the other parts of my life, but having succeeded and learned values and skills that I can apply to this. I remember when, just a short story, when I was went to Lego and I started with, you know, one of those things, they, you get all these subjects. I delayed going to Legon for a year because I wanted to go into the School of Admin. I didn't get admission to the School of Admin in the first year, so I decided to work for a year and then reapply. Then I worked for a year as a teaching assistant, reapplied, and I didn't get into the School of Admin. And so I got, but the subjects I got were geography, linguistics, Spanish, and English. And along the line, I was like, you know, if I'm going to do things I don't like, I might as well do something I like and then just get out of this space. So in level 200, I went to see Professor Martin Owusu of the School of Performing Arts, and I said, I want to do performing arts. And then he said, when you don't do well in your subjects, then you come and say you want to do performing arts. I said, Prof, I'm not doing badly. He said, go to the Great Hall and bring me your transcripts before I accept you in the School of Performing Arts. So I printed the transcript, brought it to him, and he said, A star, A, B plus, you're not doing badly. I said, no, sir. He said, so you want to do this because you love it? I said, yes, sir. And he said, you are in. And that's how I got into the School of Performing Arts. So it's not because we are not doing well in other areas that we choose performing arts. We choose it because we love it and we have an impact to make. Thank you. Next slide, please. So Ajete's journey, you speak to your journey.
My journey, pretty focused and well-defined, very, very simple. Well, I've always wanted to be a stage and screen actor. It didn't start as easy as that because I wasn't sure what I wanted to do. I think my parents were of the old stock a bit, but probably a bit modernized. And so they weren't very insistent on, you're going to do this. My daddy was a bar chemist. And unfortunately for him, I had other examples of daddies because I was exposed to movies quite early. And my daddy's life was just work home, you know, and he was always in the lab or doing something. And we didn't have social activities, going out on the picnics, like what I saw in the movies, where daddies would take their children out for a walk to the park. It was exciting to see. And I compared that to my daddy. And I thought that somehow his job was making him, you know, fall short of that. And so I didn't see biochemists or the sciences as an area where I'll delve into because it would make me like him. And I wanted to be a more fun-like dad who would, you know, have lots of fun with the children while they're young. And so that alone, I didn't really want to do any science thing. and it wasn't because I was doing so poorly in sciences too. I was doing averagely well. And what he told me was that, well, whatever that I intend to do, I should be amongst the best or be the best. And so he would just guide me. And that was just my break because others in my time didn't have it that easy. And so, well, because of the influence of watching movies that my uncles introduced me to, I was always fascinated about how people take up characters and they live it up so well, and yet they are not the characters in real life. I thought that was fascinating. And whenever I did get an opportunity in school, normally we have this Easter programs or Christmas time, and I found myself in the drama department, and they cast me and I play a role, and everybody's looking at me like, ah, how am I able to play it so easy and so much flair and convincingly? And I'm like, I don't know what they're talking about, because for me, I was just imitating what I see in their movies and playing it just, and they kept saying that I had this flair, but I still wasn't sure at that time. And so while we're just still figuring out, after national service, I think, we had this long vacation, and I heard the National Drama Company was doing an audition. And so I said, why not? While I was whiling away the time, let me just go there and try my luck. And then I just went to audition, and they picked me to be a guest artist for the National Drama Company, which was a big deal because in those days, you're going to go to act with the people like David Dontos, Akoffe Jannies, and all that. And these are people because social media didn't exist. And so these are people you'd have to walk out and, you know, meet by accident in town. But here I am, I'm going to be in the same space with them, and I thought that was thrilling. And I'm going to learn from some of the best as well. So while I was there, I was learning from them, and they kept impressing on me that there was something that I had, and it needed polishing, it needed some value to be added. And so they pushed me to go to school while I was still figuring out what I wanted to do. You know, in the course of that, you know, so yes, I joined. I had TV theater, Nyankunto Players, of course, Fast Food, Ebi Bigroma, where I developed my talent through skill development and further education.
And you say you skipped the part about being in the industry for 30 years.
There.
When we're putting the slides together, he said I shouldn't put it there. That'll make people think he's old.
Anyway, so yes, I've
1994.
I've been in the industry since 1994. Yeah, that long. So, so yes, and you know, at every point or every stage, it's like God was retracing my steps. You know, get back to that area, get back to that area. And if I even tell you how I even got scholarship for school,
yeah,
it was just amazing. I mean, it was through no work of mine.
Actually, chasing you to find you.
I was being chased, looking for Ajete Anna to come do a master's program, fully paid for. And, you know, at the end of the day, I was even given a per diem and all that.
Yeah.
And stipends, I was like, okay, where is this coming from? You know, I didn't know Elikem by then, you know, and so that I said, okay, why not? And then I had the opportunity, went to do my master's and came down. And every time you realize that the opportunities that were coming my way was just guiding, emphasizing and confirming that this is the area that God wanted me to be in and make a difference and make an impact. And of course, the stage and film productions led me to all these countries where I had a taste of, you know, the other side of the industry and what was going on in other parts of the world, which also added to my repertoire and knowledge and exposure. Okay, next slide. So I've always, I mean, later on when I discovered this, I've always believed in sharing my gift to develop others. And so when opportunities like being a lecturer at NAFTI and then at Craft Film School, I took it on because I believe that in my time, we didn't have so much of that. And you really have to do things on your own. And I thought that, look, this would be a fine way of impacting these young people. And for me, lecturing at NAFTI is not just you know, imparting knowledge, but making them responsible for the choices that they're making, because it's a creative hub space, and whatever content we put out there will be consumed. As to whether the outcome is poison or good food is another thing. And I believe that these young people needed to be mentored, needed to be given examples. And so for me, it's a theoretical space where I move from there, and then they have a practical experience in the movies that I do. So it's always testing theory, you know, in my movies, and there's always feedback, and they're able to relate to what I'm teaching and how I employ some of the techniques that I'm teaching. And, you know, so it's a very, very fine balance, and I love doing that because I'm helping nurturing some young talents out there with so much potential who would make an impact, hopefully. I co-produce Sink or Swim, A Perilous Journey, a film about irregular immigration, where this migration was, you know, the was making news then, and which was endorsed by the International Organization for Migration. It also won an award in New Jersey, and this was mainly for that department, and so we didn't really open it up for the public space because we're more or less producing it for them. Yeah. Then, of course, there's a new film co-produced. This was a film that we did last year called Porn, which will be out soon. And it was really demanding because I think I played about three characters at the same time. It really tested me and it stretched me. And so I can't wait to see the work that I've done myself. Okay, next slide. Take over.
So this is on our... what we call, let's say, talent and faith. So we believe that every gift and talent is given to help us fulfill our purpose. We are not here just to add up to the numbers. Every one of us has a gift and a talent that is supposed to be used to contribute to the society. As the Bible says, that the gifts are given for the edification of the church, not just the spiritual gifts, but also these. We need to use our gifts and talents to encourage, to help, to edify, to draw people's attention, to teach. As the Bible says, that all scripture is for teaching, rebuking, etc. If we're on stage and we are putting a performance together, which causes you to reflect on the choices that you are making, causes you to reflect on the consequences of the choices you are making for other generations, then we are using our gifts or talent to do the work of God and to do what the Bible is doing for us. So we believe that every gift is given to help us fulfill our purpose. We also believe in these scriptures, Exodus 35:10, which says that all of us who are skilled are to come and make everything that the Lord has commanded. We need to come and put together, or contribute our quota to what God expects us to be doing in ministry. All who are gifted artisans among you shall come and make all that the Lord has commanded. This scripture is in reference to when everyone, all the craftsmen and all the goldsmiths and all that were brought together in Exodus to use every gift and talent to fulfill God's purpose. Then Proverbs 18:16 tells us that a man's gift makes room for him and brings him before great men. Sometimes, I just hear nice says, you know, there are times when we, this is gossip to the to the object. Hey, hi. But we sometimes get a call from Reverend Okran and Lady Comfort, and they are talking to us, and we are like, hey, Charlie. Charlie, look how they are talking to us. Like, we have something special, you know? And we feel so honored to be before people of great achievement and great repute. And sometimes we go before certain people, and there are times when Ajete tells me maybe he had an opportunity to go somewhere before certain people, and the way they talk to him, and he's like, hey, so only because of this gift, you know? And this scripture is real, that a man's gift makes room for him and brings him before great men. So every one of us needs to find that gift and harness that gift, because that's what will open certain doors and lead you, as our General Abasia says, into the corridors of power. There are certain places you will not go if you do not harness your gifts to the point that people are willing to recognize you and reward you for it. And then 1 Peter 4:10, which says that each of us, as I emphasized earlier, should use our gifts to serve others as faithful stewards of God's grace, of God's varied grace. None of us is given our gift for our benefit. It is for serving others. And the gift we have belongs to God. All our resources, even our money, that's a conversation for a different day, but our money is also, it also belongs to God. And he expects us to be good stewards of it. Our children belong to God. He expects us to be good stewards of them. What are we doing with our children's lives and all the other resources that he has given us? So we need to use them to serve others and to serve God. So that is our basic philosophy about our gifts and talents. The next slide talks about deployment. So after all that, after we have identified, discovered our gifts, after we have developed it, what do we do with our gifts and talents? So for Ajete and I, we have both been in service, in ministry, for the past, it's about 14 years now. So I started from ICGC Holy Ghost Temple in the children's ministry. I was there for about 4 years. And then I moved into Christ Temple. When we got married, we moved to McCarthy also. We moved to Christ Temple. And right in the year 2007, when we got married, we joined the youth ministry. And we've been working with the youth since then. And in 2018, Dr. Osabo called both of us to join the dramatic arts ministry. We joined for a while, we ran away, and he called us back to and officially made us coordinators of the dramatic arts ministry. And since then, we've been working as coordinators at different levels. We've been doing supporting with developing programs for Greater Works, for GFM, Gold, Frankincense and Mare, for Easter, for anniversary, etc. We ourselves, most of the things that are done in dramatic arts are dance. We ourselves are not dance choreographers, but we have a lot of people. And one of the things we've done apart from those we met in the church who already had creative skills and talents, we brought people from the industry. So we have people who are now part of ICGC because we brought them to take part in ministry, to bring their gift and talent to serve. And by God's grace, there's a lot more that we are going to do along the line. And so, like I mentioned, we engage professionals in the creative industry to church to support a ministry, and then we keep them in church, which is one of our core responsibilities, to bring people and to win souls, to bring them to Christ. So, and we put together creative pieces for a ministry. And we are also working on capacity building. I mentioned earlier that we jointly founded a business called Meraki. And one of the things that we always tell our partners and our creative partners and directors in Meraki is that, in fact, to add that, every single member of Meraki Arts Africa is an ICGC member. We are a business with 13 partners, all shareholders, and every one of our shareholders is an ICGC member. There's nobody who is not a member of ICGC. Every one of us, and even our support staff, are all ICGC members. We met in the church, and we believe that God drew us to each other, because when we started talking about starting the business, we met all these people who were fantastic in their various fields, in marketing, in finance, in accounting. We have partners who are in building and construction, and all of them were part of the dramatic arts ministry or spirit. Dancers, actors, all passionate about the creative arts. So when we brought the business proposal together, it was very easy to get them to say, yes, this is what we've been dreaming about. And so one of the things we keep saying is that we are building capacity out there so that we can do ministry better, so that we can bring commercial productions to the church, because we know our general overseer is passionate about the creative arts, and it's not just for us to come and watch and even just receive, you know, ministration, but also for the performing artists to make money. We need to put out wholesome content on screen and on stage that people are willing to pay for, because there's a lot of rubbish on stage and on screen now, and people pay money to go and watch those things, and their minds are being filled with all sorts of things. So why not the church? And if we have the professionals here, both business and creative, then we can create content that will impact the world with the word of God. So that is our core mandate. So that's what we are doing right now, is building capacity, and watch out for it. There's a lot going to happen. Next. So we spoke about for ministry, and now for business. I think we've spoken a little about Meraki Arts right now. And so these are some of the things that we've done. We mentioned we're a network of creative and business professionals. We've had two art exhibitions, which we did in partnership with Oyarifa Mall and a few other sponsors. And also a dance performances with Alliance Francaise. And we were given our biggest opportunity yet by the Springboard Roadshow Foundation. Please put your hands together. And we want to say a very big thank you publicly to Lady and Reverend Okran. I know we don't take it lightly. We do not take it lightly. And I believe that it was one of the opportunities that made me get the confidence that I needed to step out from the corporate world into the creative space, knowing that I have an opportunity that is going to grow bigger and bigger to get to the destination that we need to get to. And so this program, by the way, if you're not following Ghana Grows on Instagram, Facebook, social media, YouTube, it's a groundbreaking program in Agric and TVET, and it's a mindset program aimed at teaching the youth to change attitudes, knowledge, attitude, and perceptions about Agric and TVET. We are an example. Meraki is an example of what Ghana Grow stands for, because every single person in Meraki, apart from being in the creative space, is also in a different profession. Every one of us has got two sides of us. So we are people in construction, as I mentioned, who are building the creative industry. We have a partner who is a senior manager at KPMG, who is also deep in the creative industry. And then there's all those who are doing But I think I mentioned Yai Solomon, who is in the creative industry. She's a lecturer in marketing at the University of Ghana, and he's one of our partners. So we believe in the power of TVET. We believe in the power of Agric, and the fact that every single one of us has the opportunity, you know, to use the resources that we have as a nation to generate wealth and to build the economy. So these are the values that we stand for. And once again, we are grateful for the opportunity. So the next slide, I hope you're not tired of hearing my voice because I mentioned that I talk more. I think I just say you can take this one. This is our last slide, I think. Yeah, yeah. So winning strategies, what has made it possible for us to do the little things that we've been able to do and to be on the verge of the next stage of our lives? I think you can take this.
Yeah, I'll be pretty straightforward. Understanding that God is the source of our gifts and talents and finding the purpose for which they were given and staying on course to fulfill our purpose. We always have to go back. It's more like doing a refresher course and going back to that reminder and to that basic foundation that will spare you on, because sometimes we are caught in our work so much so that we even forget why we're doing what we're doing and why we're called. Yeah. For a certain purpose, so we need to go back to it. Partnerships, we talked about my creative skills and network, and alums business skills and network combined, the combination that we have in ensuring that you know, we can impact much more than if we were doing it individually. Network, every relationship counts, and of course, don't burn your bridges, which is one thing that we've learned very much, and I think that it's important that we don't fall into the space where we think that we're done with people because we are doing better than them now. But you know, the world is such a it's such a small place that one day you're going to meet those same people who you look down upon, or you didn't leave well. I've seen people who have really left badly. I worked with the packaging company, and I was treated badly, but I always, you know, give him the due respect that he gave him my first opportunity. Yeah. And, you know, down the line, you're going to meet these same people. And as Elom left Legacy and Lexi some time back, she comes back. And today, look, if she had, you know, offended them in any way, abused them in any way, we don't think that this relationship would have existed. And so it's important that we learn not to burn our bridges. Yeah. No matter how we're treated badly, sometimes we need to go through that phase to be toughened for the next opportunity that is coming ahead.
Yeah, I mean, I want to add something to that. One of the things I saw in the corporate world a lot was people resigning with immediate effect. Like, you've worked in an organization, you know that your role is sensitive and your employer needs you to play the role. And then you have an opportunity which makes you feel like you can rub it in their faces and walk off. And a lot of people just drop a letter today and they're gone tomorrow. I know, I see some people smiling. Maybe they've done it before. I think you can ask for forgiveness. But the truth is that you can't undermine someone's employment and think that yours is going to go well. You need to do the right thing. It's different when there are situations which are beyond your control. But if your intention is to let them know that I can do better and I have other opportunities, then you're burning your bridges, because tomorrow you will need them. And that is an undeniable fact. You will need all those relationships. So
submit to people in authority and those ahead of you, very also key. Be humble. Nobody knows it all. We have to keep learning, to keep growing. This is one thing that I learned in our field, because we have a group of people called celebrities. And so there's the temptation for them to feel that they are here and the rest of the world is there. And so even the attitude, for example, we come on set and maybe there's a new entrant who perhaps is going to have his or her first experience in movie. There's this posture or posturing of the celebrities. It's like, oh, young girl, come up here and let me teach you a few, you know, tricks about acting. Yeah. You know, they don't say it, but the posturing is all like, you know, I'm the boss. Yeah. Forgetting that this new entrant coming in has something embedded in him or her, like gifting that you don't have. And so you shut out, you don't learn. And that's how you keep staying at this level. Yeah. But if you open your eyes, you know that everybody is unique. They carry a gifting. It's all a part of connecting the chain so that we impact together. You are going to observe that person coming in and pick something that he or she has a flair or does something so marvelous. And then you pick it up and add it to yours, and then you stay relevant. Yeah. So it's very key that we are not caught in a place of we know it all, and then, you know, everybody must come to us for apo, if you will. Maintain your dignity and self-respect. Say no when opportunities are against your values. Those opportunities will come, whether you like it or not. But you have to go back to the basics.
Why
you are here, why God has called you. And that's the main reason why God wants to use you, to be able to stand firm and say no and maintain that dignity and respect. Let me share this very briefly. The time when, I think a few of you have heard this, if not, when I was offered an opportunity by an alcoholic beverage company. This was when I was we were in ministry at
you
youth.
Did one. Where, you remember, you did one.
We're youth facilitators. Yeah, the
so
first
long
one.
Ago. That
my eyes was not opened.
Yeah.
But when God confirmed that this is what I wanted to do, I was like, well, okay, we need to
we need to
correct that error.
Yeah.
And so I was given a bigger opportunity,
a
but
huge
this one,
one
was huge. It was the biggest, like, budget that
I was tempted
ever seen.
To say you should do it.
And
I
it was at the same
confess.
Time that we were on our knees praying for
we're
a breakthrough,
broke.
Financial breakthrough. And then here comes this blessing. I was like, this is a blessing. God has answered our prayers. But there's a way in which, you know, you are there and something knocks and said, hey, Charlie, this job, think about it.
Because at that time, we were neck deep in youth ministry.
That's
and,
right.
And, you know, we had a conversation that, what if he does this? And this was like one of the biggest alcoholic beverage companies in the world. And it was a big job.
And they wanted to use the character Pusher
to tell the story
Pusher days to, you know.
It was supposed to be for the whole continent. It was from Nigeria. I mean,
And you see, the dilemma was that here was I've been mentoring young people in the youth ministry.
How do you explain
young
it?
Boys, and I keep encouraging them to study, keep to their books, no drugs, no alcohol, you know. And then here am I, offered an alcoholic beverage commercial, which is huge. And I'm there, I'm like, okay, I'm not going to drink it. So I told them that I can't drink the alcohol. They're like, no, okay, I don't have to drink it. Blah, blah, they'll find a way out. But then Elop also put and said that, but hey, I'm endorsing the product, am I not? So I was caught in that dilemma, because for me, what was even more difficult for me is that I know that if I ventured to do this commercial, these young boys would meet me after Sunday and say that, hey, Akajete, you said we shouldn't drink alcohol, but we saw you in that alcoholic beverage advert. That alone, images, that's what they remember. And what you've done, more than the words that I was like, Charlie, this is hard, but Charlie, we have to let it go and trust God for another opportunity, but this is not ours. And painfully, we had to let it go. But God being so good, we were rewarded. And it was just it continues. It continued. And so being reminded that we need to maintain our dignity and self-respect, so many offers will come our way that seems good and a blessing, but sometimes it's just a disguise, and we have to go back to the basics to remind ourselves again why God has called us. In the social media age, where significance is about followers and likes, seek to keep grounded and focused on your true north. Seek to please God more than the world. We're caught in those spaces as well. These days, it's all about numbers. It's all about numbers, and if I can have the numbers. Of course, which it has its positives, because corporate organizations and brands and products are looking for those numbers to be able to make impact with their products. But we also have to be careful that we're not caught in those spaces where it's like numbers against values or principles. And so we have to be careful that we drive social media spaces and not the other
and
way
then
around.
We influence with our numbers, to be influenced by the numbers.
Then seek role models and mentors who have blazed the trail you desire to be on, build on their strengths and do better than their weaknesses. One of the things that I observed with when I stepped into the industry was not just build on strengths of some of my people I call mentors, but also look at what they didn't do so well. And sometimes it's even when they step out of character and the way they talk to somebody, you know, somebody who is not an actor, and I'm like, okay, that's a bit rude just because you're a star in quotes. And I'm like, okay, I'm not going to do that when I'm in that space, because these are the same people who patronize your products. They buy tickets to come watch you. And so you cannot treat them as second class citizens. You have to raise them above there, because they keep you in business. And we need to have that, you know, connectivity and family. And so I'm also very careful that I don't position myself that way. But models and mentors at every turn, there's always somebody who we're looking up to. Whenever we have challenges, we're quick enough to say that, look, this is bigger than us. Let us reach people who have walked that path. What are the lessons that they learned? What advice can they give to us? And that is why we don't joke with Rev here and Lady here, because they know. I mean, we've knocked on their doorstep.
We'll be at their house at 10 p.m. asking questions.
They have contributed enormously to our relationship and our marriage.
Yeah.
And it's just been discovering. I mean, when the words discover, develop, and deploy. These are things that is unending. We keep discovering.
We keep developing. We keep deploying,
and thanks be to God, we're still here, and hopefully we can make much impact. Yeah.
Yes. So, thank you. And one of the things that we should add is that by God's grace, we have a project coming up, and it's a project that is going to put together all that we have talked about. Our key desire is that we would impact family, marriages, and the youth. Well, let's start rather the youth family, or the youth marriages and family. So we're putting a project together, which we hope will be really big, and hint, it's on the screen, and we're looking to do it in partnership with some very well-established people, and this, at the end of the day, is seeking to bring wholesome content out there on the screen on a continuous basis. And by God's grace, hopefully by June or July, we should be showing you some good stuff. So thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
we are ready for questions.
Please be seated.
Okay.
Round of applause for them one more time. So let me acknowledge our teaming fans watching us online. Daniel Asante Asari says, this is just so beautiful. Let me see again, a couple of them. So Sylvia Lina Destiny says, my big takeout, submit to people in authority. So I'm coming to you to find out your one big takeout. But if you have a question for Elom and Ajeti, about talents, about grooming, about winning strategies, about partnership, about discovery, about development, and about deployment, please take your position behind the microphone and ask them your questions. But thanks for sharing your life with us. It's a rare thing to be able to share your whole life in 1 hour, but you've done the very best of summarizing two lives into one. Elom, as I reflect on what you've said, Prof, I can't help but think about the fact that she obviously has pivoted from an actress to a specialist in the business of creative arts. And from where you sit as an authority, and congratulations on your latest listing across the continent, Prof, from where you sit, how important is the specialized business knowledge that she wrote her thesis in and is spearheading?
Thank you very much, Reverend Albert. First of all, congratulations to the two of you. Excellent, excellent presentation. You want to ask how special it is? It's too special. And the reason is the creative art sector is the key to Africa's next level. I've said it everywhere I go, that if we harness the creative sector well, Africa will export itself in ways it can't even imagine, because there's so much good talent in music, in film, in theater, but we are still trying to wrap our mind around it. So I really compliment you for working in the space. I published a book 2 years ago entitled The Creative Sector and International Business for Africa, where I was making the thesis that the creative sector is the next level. So I can only encourage them to keep refining their craft, but to keep building a business model that's not just local, but Pan-African as well. Because in the context of the Africa Continental Free Trade Area, I think the creative space is one of the biggest things that can occur in that sector. So kudos to them, and they can only get higher. Congratulations.
Thank you. Let me go to lawyer and ask you, as we navigate these thoughts, we are now entering the deep waters. From your position as a legal practitioner, what are some of the untapped areas, the gray areas, the areas people don't consider that somebody in this talent conversation must start wrapping their minds around if they want to swim in the deep waters? I'm asking from the legal perspective, what comes to your mind as people think about discovering a talent and converting it into a business? What are some of the areas that people get into? One thing somebody said to me, for instance, is copyright. Copyright awareness and considerations. And from where you sit, what are some of the common mistakes people make that they should be paying attention to as they think about turning their talent into a business?
Thank you very much, Reverend. And congratulations to you, Ajete and Elom. I must say that the common mistakes I have identified as a lawyer is that most professionals, especially those in the creative art industry, tend to believe that because they have attained their celebrity status, there are a lot of things they can do and without consulting professionals, other professionals, okay, they assume they are supermen and superwomen and can go ahead and do all kinds of things, hoping that wherever they have pitfalls, they can get the professionals to claw back or to then help them address it. But that is reactionary rather than taking a very proactive step, which means you can actually retain lawyers like me and we'll charge you a small fee. Once in a while, you send Momo to us, you know, we'll have a great relationship. So that every step you take, you consult us. I had to run late for this program because I went into a meeting somewhere. And it doesn't cost much to consult other professionals, be they accountants or lawyers, on the project you want to embark on. Carry them along through every step of the journey so that you are giving guided advice every step of the way. You will avoid all the pitfalls so that you don't spend money correcting your mistakes thereafter. And it will cost you so much more, okay, trying to correct those pitfalls vis-a-vis if you had engaged us, carried us along every step of the way. So my suggestion humbly to you and all others in the creative industry is that other professionals are always available to you. Be humble enough to contact and consult them. You don't know it all. The same way we as lawyers don't know it all. There are instances where we actually speak to other professionals just to guide us on the cases we are working on or the other steps we want to take. So thank you very much.
Thank you so much. I think this is so important. As Meraki, we actually do have some lawyers on retainership. So it's one of the things that, in fact, it's too expensive. So maybe we will come and find out if you will make it cheaper for us. But the truth is that it's one of the things we didn't take for granted from the start. So, and the lawyers that we have currently are intellectual property specialists. So because of the nature of the products that we do, the creative products. So it's very important, and it's something that we will also continue to teach the other people that we would be working with along the line. So thank you so much for confirming that we are doing the right thing.
Thank you very much. You're better safe than sorry. Yeah. All right, let's hear from you. So which part of the creative arts are you in? Music, drama, dance, theater?
I dance. I'm a dancer.
Dance.
And I dabble in
Do you believe
theater.
In
theater?
No, we don't.
Do you believe that he's a dance
instructor?
No, we
don't. He said he's a dance instructor.
Do you believe that he's a dance instructor?
No.
Action speaks louder than words.
Than words.
If he's a dance instructor, does he need
music? Can we play some music?
Does he need music or he can do it without music?
He can do it without music. But
without music, okay. How many want to hear him, see him dance? How many want to see the dance? All those in favor say aye.
He looks more like a bodybuilder than a dancer.
All those again say no. The eyes have it. Okay, Charlie.
The eyes have it. There hey, music go. Is already coming. So, hey.
Am I teaching or dancing?
Come and do it. Yeah,
practice it. Oh, moral for you.
Moral. Ah, which song is this?
You have earned the
okay,
right
we believe
the
you, we believe you.
Madam, do you know how to dance? Madam, next question. Do you know how to dance? Or you sing? Or you act? Please, you must know something before you come. All right, say, go ahead.
Yes, so thank you very much. I have two questions. Okay. And the first would be the individual. So, can I? So, a Christian going into the creative arts industry. Mm-hmm. Right now, sadly, it is dominated by the world. And like you said, there's a lot of things out there and people are, absorbing those things.
Yeah.
What advice would you give a Christian who wants to go into the creative arts industry? And then the second question is about the collective. Why are Christian groups, let's say in churches, and not able to break into this creative arts industry and thrive in it? Why is it that you always hear that a lot of the worldly groups are the ones dominating, getting all the money, getting all the endorsements, and then we have the church groups who are usually stagnant where they are, and then eventually, because they have to take care of themselves and their families,
they
go into something else.
Okay. So I think I'll speak to the first one. You want to speak to that? Okay. So about the individual you said who is in the creative space and you know, you're wondering why you're not impacting or why. Can you just repeat that part? It's like, how do you make an impact in the creative space as a Christian? Right. Okay. So, I mean, lately, I'm very old school when it comes to Christian music. In fact, Ajay introduced me to Elevation Worship and Maverick City and Hillsong, and I didn't like those. I was like Vine Song, Maranatha music, very old school, you know, and very local tree worship music. But I started hearing these songs in the last few years, and I started asking myself, like, there's so much more happening out there in the world of Christian music. And lately, my son has introduced me to Limo Blaze and Moses Bliss, and what was the last one you've been listening to recently? What's the name? Louis Pascal, you know, and this is fun dancing music. Okay, I mean, I listen to the lyrics and, you know, the message behind them, scriptural, fun, funky. These guys are dressing well. Moses Bliss and Cole will come with fine boy way, love Jesus vibe, you know. And I'm asking myself, and actually his cousin, my niece, she said to me that I have a whole 2-hour collection of Christian party music. Okay, so my question is that if that's what we like, because me, I can't dance, so the hip-hop guy, I'm in pe. Okay, but then if it is about dancing and like what you did, I didn't hear the words of the music, but it's Christian music, right? And this is the kind of dance that people are dancing out there in the clubs and all that. So why can't we make it fun? Sessions like these in church make it easy for us to express ourselves. We can create more opportunities to have fun as Christians, you know, play games, go out there and chat. We are now, all the musicians in the church are wearing earrings and doing dreadlocks. So nobody's stopping us from doing that anymore. So if we can find our, our vibe, we can find our groove in the church and still play great, good, wholesome music. Why are we feeling left out? I mean, I've never gone to the club, even when I was not born again. I never went to the club because my mother wouldn't let me. Like, you can't go anywhere, even your friend's party. So I don't know what the life out there is. Like, I've probably been to a club once in my life and I slept throughout because I was coming from work and it was a friend's party and I ended up there and I was too exhausted, so I fell asleep. But for me, what is the thrill if we have the music that makes us happy, that makes us excited, and we can do that in the church? So it's for us to change the narrative. If we want to make it fun, we can make it fun. The creative space is too big for us to let the world dictate its terms and conditions to us. We can create our own. We can create our own niche and make it work. That's my opinion.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. I think that you delved into, I think that one of the reasons why it seems that the secular spaces thrive more when it comes to the creative spaces. Sometimes you even have talented people, most of the time, have talented people in the church. And we've seen from, you know, the global stage, the Whitney Houston's, even the Beyoncé's, starting from the church and getting that, you know, upbringing, nurturing, and then they go into this the secular world and they are caught up in there and they are lost. And so we need to find a way in which we make church more exciting for this new generation and trend, so that the perception of, oh, if it's church, then I'm limited, I can't express myself, it's boring and all that. How do we still make it exciting, fun, still value-based, still the principles that we want to ensure that we're instilling in them are not sacrificed, but making it very fun in order that they stay and exhibit their God-given talent. And so that is a task for all of us to look at, so that we keep the talents in that spaces, we nurture them, give them that grounding before they go into the world to exhibit and impact, you know, bigger lives, so that they are not lost, because that foundation is needed to be ground for them to be grounded before they are successful. Yeah. So it's something that we're together working on as well.
And in terms of commercialization, just to add to that, in terms of the commercialization you mentioned, TD Jakes is doing very big Christian movies, right? There's so much Christian movies, I mean, out there, so many of them. And the opportunities that we have are endless. We, as Meraki, want to start creating films that will be out there, will premiere them with the same pomp and pageantry that all the worldly films are being produced. But that is bringing out wholesome content. It might not be films that are showing people in church praying, but it's teaching you values about faith, about honesty, about dignity, about truth, about purity. And so every one of us will be able to relate to it and the right values will be imparted. So the commercialization is coming and it's up to all of us to play our roles.
Thank you very much. Yes, Elon, if I may just add, and that's why your study is much more important than you think. If you restrict it to something you did for your thesis or something you did for your business alone, I think it goes way beyond that. Yeah. And I'm surprised none of you mentioned Tyler Perry.
Tyler Perry.
When he broke into the space, it was deemed to be impossible to show
something the richest,
that had a Christian conclusion and hit some numbers. But here we are.
Yes.
The rest is history.
It's history, yes.
Right, final question for you. Will you sing, dance, or preach before you ask the question?
Or rap.
Which mic is faulty?
Mine.
Okay. All right.
Hi. So I have two questions. You know the quote that says, "Jack of all trades, master of none." There are some of us that find ourselves in a space where it's like we know how to do a lot of things, and we keep hearing, You are doing everything, Sam. Focus on one. But you also realize that all the other things that you are able to do, you are able to do them well to the best of your ability. How do you fine-tune that for yourself? And secondly, this is not really in relation to talent, but I realize that because both of you have similar interests, how does the young Christian woman currently, I mean, when you are trying to find someone to get married to, what did you do at that time when you were young? Because currently we find that there are people that say, oh yeah, woman, show signs, do A, B, C, D, and then they'll use Boaz's story and try and do something to show that you're available, all of that. What do you think helped you at that age that you were and helped you to find him and you've been able to figure out everything in your life? Thank you.
We have not figured out everything in our lives. At all. At all. Okay, you start. I think the first part is...
The first question is about being multi-talented. So let's take a minute for that one. Yeah. The second question is about how you found him. That one is to you.
So I think that you really have to focus on a few. You know, because the thing is, you wouldn't want to be half-baked for any one of them. Each of them demand your full attention to be able to, you know, make a full impact. And so if you ask me, you know, the best two would be your focus. You can keep an eye on the third, but the best two so that you have good results. What I did, because I find myself lecturing as well and acting at the same time, and I needed to find a synergy in how these two are connected so that it becomes more purposeful and impactful. And I found it in the space where I enjoy teaching, not just teaching, but also a task that I've put on myself as being a mentor for these young people, so that whatever they are learning, they have a practical example of what I'm doing in the practicals when I'm performing. And so I'm not just teaching them things that are abstracts, but things that they can see for themselves and test and come back and ask me questions. Why did I employ this technique and not that technique? And for me to explain. And also give me an opportunity to learn from them, because sometimes they do have brilliant ideas and I don't shut myself out. And so find a way in which you can have a synergy between the two that are topmost, that are related, so that you can harness, you know, so much from it. So it's your calling, but don't, as you said, jack of all trades, and so you have to zoom into about two.
Okay. I mean, just to add, like, there's someone, one of our creatives, our creative directors in Meraki, says that some of the creative skills are jealous arts, and so he finds himself to be a designer. He does a costume design, and that's dance, and he loves photography, and he says all of them are jealous because they all demand a lot of time to work on them. So you need to pick, like he's saying, the top two that are related, that are connected, that you can do together, you know, and then develop those as well. So I wish you all the best. About how I found Ajayi, I wasn't looking for him. I wasn't looking for a husband. I wasn't even looking for a boyfriend. I found him pursuing my love for the creative arts. I happened to get into acting because I just wanted to try it out, just for fun. And when I got in there, when I got the opportunity, my first intrigue about it was, oh, I get to meet Pusha, you know, just for fun. And so then I met him and I was like, oh, he's a nice guy, he's a nice person. And then we started to talk and then it grew into a friendship and all that. So I think maybe because I was very young, I think I met him when I was like 21 or something, and we got married when I was 24. So I think maybe at that time, I wasn't really intentional about trying to find a life partner. So maybe if you are at the stage where you're intentional, then maybe push yourself into the space where you love, and you'll probably find the person that you want to spend the rest of your life with there. I really wish you all the best. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I love this. I love this. The last one was the icing on the cake.
Okay.
All right. So
thank you.
Have you enjoyed this? So much
Thank
fun,
you.
So much learning, real, authentic conversation about life and about learnings. And trust me, with all that you've said, I still think that where you are, that is the probable gold dust on all this, is your interest in the business of it. Because many people who have talents don't understand the business of their talent. And may God grant you grace.
Amen.
To open
Amen.
And explore areas
Amen.
That no one has considered,
Amen.
Because
Amen.
That really
Amen.
Is the difference between those who do it and love it but are broke, and then those who do it and earn top dollar from their talents.
Amen. I receive it.
I'm going to ask you to lead us in a short time of prayer, because when all is said and done, if somebody's life can change tonight, and somebody can stumble on one secret to change the financial component of your talent, or even discover it, Prof, that is it. If not, you can live till 70 and still wonder what went wrong. So as we talk about this, as we talk about principles, as we talk about learnings, a 3-minute time of prayer asking God to open your eye could be the game changer of your life. And I'm going to honorably ask these two wonderful people to lead us in prayer that God will have mercy on us and open our eyes to the right place and give us the wisdom to know when we find what you are looking for.
I think first of all, just spend about a minute or two asking God, whatever that's on your heart, whatever that you desire, if it's purpose that you're finding, ask God, talk to God about it in this 1 or 2 minutes. Ask for confirmation, ask for wisdom, that He may open your heart and mind, that your desire will be linked to His will, that you find that purpose, not just for yourself, but as a source to be a blessing to His people, and ultimately an extension of His kingdom. So doing, also ask Him to bring destiny helpers your way, people who He will place in your path, in your journey, that they will not come in to take away, but they will come to impact in your life. They will add value. That when these people come your way, that you have enough wisdom and grace to identify them, because they will lead you to the next step. And so even pray that these persons are touched and that they can hear from God, that they'll be able to be the help that you need to your next level.
So Father, we just want to thank you so much for an opportunity, for sharing knowledge, for learning from each other. We thank you for the opportunity to share our story and to encourage and inspire. Father, we pray and commit everybody who has heard, everyone who is interested, everyone who is asking themselves, what's the next stage for me? We commit every single one of these people into your hands. We pray, Father, Lord Jesus, that as you have led us and taught us to know that we are just at the beginning of our journey, helped us not to be confused and not to despair and not to wonder, but you've brought us to the point where we can say we are at the first step and we are heading towards the next step. We pray for wisdom. We pray for direction. We pray for conviction for everyone under the sound of our voices. We pray, Father, Lord Jesus, that where there is chaos, you will bring calm. Where there's confusion, you will bring direction. Father, where people do not know what to do, Lord, you open their eyes and you lead them according to the purpose for which you created them. Lord, we know that every single one of us has a purpose, and so we pray that you first help us to identify the talents and gifts you've given us, that we will use them to fulfill the purpose for which you created us. Lord, we come against any spirit of confusion in the name of Jesus. We come against any spirit of despair in the name of Jesus. We come against any spirit that causes us to feel like there's no way out and we have made all the wrong choices. But as even you direct us, Father, as even when we use the GPS and we lose our way, it can reroute us and tell us you are still on the fastest route. Please help us, Lord, to listen to your voice and to know that no mistake is beyond redemption. No bad choice is beyond redirecting and rerouting. Help us, Father, that from wherever we are, you will redirect us and we will still fulfill the great destiny and purpose that you have for us. We thank you so much, Lord, and we bless you for this and all that you have done for us. In Jesus' name we've prayed. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Celebrate the Lord at GTN Elom. Thank you very much. Please celebrate the Lord. Put your hands together. Thank God for their lives. Please be seated. Thank you so much. Wow. Such an enriching time of interaction, and the prayer time was the icing on the cake. There is no mistake that is irredeemable, and may God himself guide us and bring us on track to be able to finish the race with distinction to his glory and praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we'll now take offering. We'd like to encourage you to give generously as the Lord has blessed you. And as you give, may God cause men to give to your bosom good measure, pressed down, shaking together, and running over. Never forget who you are giving to. When you are conscious of who you are giving to, it influences your giving. You are giving to God, the giver of good gifts, all good gifts. Give us the Lord as blessed with the band of minister as we receive our offering.
Thank you. We bless God. We bless God for tonight. If you are blessed, give it up to Ajete and Elom. I think Pastor Albert and Lady Comfort Okran need another round of applause, because it's only in New Wine Temple you can get all these. Kindly give me your attention for the following reminders. Sunday service. Let's meet this Sunday, 14th April, for service. First service is at 7:30 a.m. and second service at 10 a.m. Our Wednesday meeting, next Wednesday, we have Jerry Ajololo, who will be speaking to us next week on the topic, discovering, developing, and deploying your God-given talent. Let's kindly welcome Pastor Albert, even as he takes us to the
Thank you very much. Just to mention that next week I'll tell Jerry to spend time talking about the cash part of the talent. It's very important. I know Christians are very uncomfortable when you talk about the cash part. I was standing there when Jerry did his first MC job. I was standing there. I won't tell you beyond standing there what else there was. I was standing there. I was there some. And I've seen one man become a principality in an industry with several players. And there is no significant high-profile function in this country that you will not see him there. How did he do it? And how did he overthrow all those who were there before him and become the undisputed number one? And how does he transition between different governments and still be number one? It is this kind of thing that you need to hear so that you can also be number one in your field, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. So tomorrow, next week, we'll zoom in on the cash and how to dominate a competitive market. So we are climbing and touching different parts of the field. And today, Ajit and Elam have been very kind to give us insight filler about their part of the business and the commercialization or the business of the business. Let's put our hands together for them one more time. Is there anybody who's here for the very first time today? Let's see. It's getting better every day. Pastor Max, this is your first time. Anybody else here for the first time? All right. Oh, stand up. Let's give you fans. Please clap for them. Clap for them all. Oh, wow. Pastor Mark, so 1, 2, 3, 4, all of you here for the first time. So you see, PCH is matching Sunday boot for boot in bringing people for the first time. Thank you so much for joining us. Let's have a brief reception after the service, get to know you more and interact with you. God bless you. Please be seated for a couple of minutes. All right. So next week, please invite somebody. Let's have that big conversation about the competitive field that you are in, how to become the one, the brand, and then also monetizing your talent, including, Prof, tangibilizing the intangible. Yes, in marketing, service marketing, tangibilizing the intangible. What you are selling is not tangible, but how to make it tangible. In honor of Ajete and Elom, I'm giving out their best-selling book today, 2 copies. And to the glory of God, they didn't even bring the soft cover. They brought the hard case cover. That's twice the price. Who wants it? Please, when you get it, don't go to that page. Read the whole book. Don't go to the page that the whole Ghana wanted to read first. This one was presented by Elom. The one who will win this one, Elon will present it. Then the one who will win this one, Ajiti will present it, because it is 2 books in one bag. Hey, Iraba, I beg you. This one goes to a lady born on Tuesday. The name, oh, why? Because you're not born on Tuesday, you're worried. Tuesday is winning every day. The name is Patricia Doche. Hey, Charlie, before I finish, guys, she has started moving. Patricia gets to get the first book from Elam. Put your hands together for her. Singer born on Tuesday with big dreams and trusting God to make them happen, Patricia Doche. All right, the grand prize winner gets 2 books. This is a book everyone must read. Ajiti, I love your story. I really do. And then I'm adding Petra's book, Jungle Dance, a novel, and then too good, too good. So who crowd wants this? Okay, let's see. I used to come and pick it. So when you pick, they'll believe you. As you shake the person's hand, may they go internet. Hey, don't pick two. It's one book.
So this goes to Sandra. What's the name?
It's Arthur.
Okay. Sandra Arthur. Are you here? Ah, well, congratulations.
So she's won two books.
Have you had a good time?
Sorry?
Have you had a good time?
Oh, yes, I have. I have. I just didn't get enough time to talk about the book, but I'm sure for a later date, we'll delve into that one.
Should we do a whole show on the book?
I think we should.
Starting from that page?
Well, no problem. I mean,
hey! Good to see you as always. Thank you so much. Put your hands together for Ajite Elelom. So the story of their lives is captured in this book, and I love the fact that even though you see it as Ajite's biography, they actually co-wrote it. So they write one chapter, then they pass, just like how they spoke. One writes one chapter, then back pass. And it's very nicely put together. Very, very interesting book, and I'm sure you would love it so much. All right. So thank you all for coming. I want somebody to give me a 30-second vote of thanks. Who will volunteer? 30 seconds. Prof.
Hallelujah. If you don't respond, you can go home. Hallelujah. I can talk for 30 minutes. So I want to thank God for the lives of these illustrious human beings, for the lessons they've shared. For the last slide should be a template for husband-wife business success. So thank you very much for coming. Thank you for sharing. And I pray that what you've shared with us will transform our lives. And make her today. I wore ripped jeans because of you, because I wanted to feel like I can act in a pusher movie. So thank you very much, and God bless us. So, Jerry Adololo, he was my student. So next week I'll be sitting here again. He didn't finish the course, so when he comes, he'll confess before you. What you say, Prof is here? Then you say I didn't finish the course. So next week, come and listen to that teaser. He started, but because of the money, I didn't see Jerry again. But he's still a good man. I love him very much. Thank you and God bless you all. Please stand up and let's pray. Father, we thank you for the blessing of children in the house of God who've devoted themselves to excellence. We pray that their lives will be a shining example to us. May our lives be transformed because we came to church tonight. And as we go forth, may our path continue to shine brighter and brighter onto a perfect day. We thank you for traveling mercies as we go. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you, sir. Thank you.